Welcome to the Predictable Revenue Podcast, where frontline sales leaders teach you how to build and scale an outbound sales team.
Hey, welcome everyone. This is Aaron Ross of Predictable Revenue. This is the Predictable Revenue Podcast. I'm joined today with Collin Stewart, actually CEO of Predictable Revenue, my partner, and Zach Barney, who's leading the SDR team at a company called Teem, that's T-E-E-M, which is on a $7 million growth path right now, hoping to triple next year. And Zach is currently managing 9 SDRs and growing that team to 24 next year in the spring. And we have him on here to try to glean some of those nuggets of knowledge from him. Now, I will say there's been multiple people who said, you have to interview Zach. He's brilliant. So, you have a lot to live up to here, Zach. Are you ready?
I'll try. I wouldn't say I'm ready, but I'll do it anyways.
You know what? Even better. Just jump right in. So with that, let's get started. Collin, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Awesome. Thanks for the intro, Aaron. And thanks for taking time to recording me a new audiobook. I'm looking forward to hearing that, man. Zach, why don't we start with just your journey into sales development? So where you got your start and how you got to Teem.
Yeah, so I kind of have an atypical pathway towards sales development. I've been in SaaS sales for about 8 years now, but in every role imaginable: sales director, account executive, VP of account management. Really started making a name for myself in the hunting space when I was at HireVue about 3 years ago. I was an account executive there. And
I think that's where we actually first met, right?
When I was at Outro, I think,
yeah.
with Bubba Page. So right before that, I was at HireVue. And while at HireVue, we were still figuring out the sales development side of things. We had some really good SDRs, but the processes were a little bit wobbly when I joined. And I just had this mindset of, hey, I'm not going to be beholden to whatever an SDR can or cannot produce for me. So I'm going to go out and figure out my own processes. I had recently read Predictable Revenue and prepped for the role. And I'm a very big believer in data. So I started generating more business on my own than was delivered to me by the sales development team. They brought on a new leader who ended up just crushing it and helping take things to the next level. And I took a lot of the principles that I learned from him, as well as things that I had figured out on my own, and started building out segmented teams at Quarterdeck, which is now Outro, and then here at Teem.
Gotcha. Great. And who is the leader that they brought in at HireVue?
Peter Chun. He's actually VP of Inside Sales at LucidChart now.
Right on.
Great friend.
Awesome. Yeah, lots of fluidity there. Great.
Absolutely.
So today we're going to talk about something that's sort of near and dear to your heart and to mine, which is how to properly comp or spiff our SDRs. We've got there's a wide range of schools of thought. So why don't we dive into, let's talk about, why don't you share your thoughts here?
Yeah, so I'm a big believer in spiffs. I feel like the right spiff can be incredibly motivating and help people go above and beyond their normal expectations. So I host the local sales hacker community here in Salt Lake. And about a year ago, we had a meetup with Dan Freund, who joined InsideSales.com as their VP of corporate sales after like a 25-year career at Oracle. And one of the things he talked about during this meetup was spiffing. And
for people that are sorry to cut you off there, for people that are like a bit newer and aren't SDR ninjas, what is a spiff?
A spiff is an immediate reward bonus, you know, in addition to your normal comp plan, in exchange for doing something that may or may not be your normal kind of quota or expectations. So
can you give me a couple examples?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've done a few spiffs lately, and I'm sure we'll talk about them in detail in a couple minutes. But in order to maintain high activity levels at the end of the month, where everybody's primarily focused on closing deals, I run spiffs rewarding sales development reps for extra high activity levels.
Awesome.
For making X number of calls as opposed to their normal expectation, or to maintain consistency throughout the course of a quarter. If you hit, you know, weekly targets for 3 weeks in a row, we'll do an award. That might not, you know, directly be tied to your compensation. You're not given, you know, extra commission if you hit a weekly target, as long as you hit your annual quota or quarterly quota. But, you know, something outside of the ordinary to motivate people that is still somehow related to results.
Awesome. So encouraging some sort of behavior that you see as critical. And it's sort of like these are like one-offs, right? It's not a, correct, this is now and forever thing. This is a short sort of burst.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool. All right. So yeah, thanks for letting us go on a tangent there. Let's back to
Dan Freund. Yeah. So he found that cash spiffs, you know, offering somebody $100 or $1,000 for hitting some target was never good enough in sales. Salespeople were inherently driven by money, and offering even more money, which is generally something minimal in comparison to their normal commissions, just never was enough to move the needle in activity or effort levels. So he found the most effective spiffs would be rewarded with something that brought an immediate joy, laughter, or something that's intangible, such as lunch with the CEO or an executive, things like that. So I've tried to mirror that in spiffs with my team, and have done a couple that have been really unique and fun and very inexpensive to do. And, you know, I've driven some pretty stellar results for us. Just yesterday, I did 383 push-ups, trying to motivate my team to keep the call volume high at the end of the month. I said I would do one push-up for every call that they made that was with a purpose. We definitely are predictable revenue believers. We don't just smile and dial all day.
Yes.
So every purpose-driven call, I did one push-up, and I'm quite sore. It's hard to move my arms right now. But it was great. I mean, it drove way better results than me armchair quarterbacking and just asking people, get your call volumes up, get your call volumes up. Why aren't you calling anymore? Instead, motivate with something positive. I don't have to spend money on that. But they knew that every single activity that they did on the phone made an immediate impact that resulted in me having to do another push-up. So they were all contributing.
Yeah.
And saw, you know, immediate results from that activity. And then, you know, also we ended up with essentially a record day for appointments set.
That's fantastic. And so, so where do you come up with these spiffs, and how do you sort of organize that and structure that so that it's sort of a consistent push, and it's not just something that, yeah, you know, Zach's doing another, you know, push-up day again, like we don't, yeah, you know, how do you keep it, yeah, fresh?
Well, I found that my team in particular just loves human suffering. So any time they can see me suffer in some way, shape or form, they love. But we definitely try to change up the activities. We do, like you said, we don't want it to be a consistent thing. We want to, you know, to change behavior, but based on something I'm noticing that we need to do at that particular moment. So another one, just to try to maintain consistency with qualified opportunities set. Anybody that hit their targets 3 weeks in a row got to smash a pie in my face a few weeks ago. And man, I have one SDR that he knows how to smash pies in people's faces. He's good. He started with my chin and just ran it up my face to where I was smelling triple berry for like 3 days.
And this is, so it's like the slow pie, not the slow one. Distance.
No, right up to my face. Not one of those cheap whipped cream things. Like, he found the heaviest pie he possibly could, then drenched it in whipped cream. Yeah, I mean, from my chin to the back of my neck, I was just drenched. But it was awesome. We live streamed it on Periscope and Facebook. We had the whole company watching, and just everybody loved it. They were talking about how awesome, how fun it is to work here, and you know, we found that their morale increased. Their results increase because of it. And it's a great recruiting tool. Like, I mean, when we're doing culture interviews with people and they ask how the culture is, people can say, well, I mean, if you want a boss that lets you smash pies in his face and does push-ups when when you do something well, then this is a place to work. And it's a really great way that we've been able to differentiate ourselves from every other company that still pays base in commissions, which we do too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fantastic. And we'll have to get the link off of you at the end of this so we can add it to the meeting notes here. If you guys have the video saved, which I hope
I've got the Periscope link for sure.
That'd be fantastic. Cool. Let's take a detour because you mentioned an interesting piece there, because it's not just a spiff and a base salary. There's obviously other components that go into that. Could we maybe divert the conversation and just have a chat about how you see sort of comp as a whole on your SDR team?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm a big fan of Mike Weinberg. Sales Management Simplified is one of the best sales books I've read. And he has a huge chapter in that book talking about comp. And regardless of what the role is in a sales organization, compensation should never be flat. You want your top performers making a lot of money. They're very valuable. And specifically in sales development, as you know, Collin, good hunters are hard to find. I mean, it's not just an entry-level position where you hire somebody in hopes that they prove themselves out and can one day be, quote, promoted into an account executive role. I hate that mindset. I think sales development is a rare talent and should be comped fairly based on that. So, you know, we do very competitive base pay, and then we compensate on the commission side, two pieces. One is based on qualified opportunities set. We don't just let people set any random appointment that has a pulse. They have to be qualified and accepted by the account executive after a meeting. Mm-hmm. And then we also give them a commission kicker for closed business. We don't want them setting $1 million deals and then feeling like the account executive gets all the credit. We want them to have a share in the glory and be motivated to set those larger deals.
Right on, man. Can we walk through, just to help everybody understand, how do you guys define, like, what does your pipeline look like? Does it start with a qualified opportunity, or what's the top of the funnel for you?
Yeah, so we have inbound and outbound dedicated reps.
Yep.
So our inbound team, number one, I need to give a shout out to our killer marketing team. We get hundreds upon hundreds of marketing qualified leads every month.
That's awesome.
And so I've got great inbounders who take that marketing qualified lead and qualify them, vet them for interest and also for position to buy. So they'll make sure that there's actually a need, that they are the right person to be talking to. Mm-hmm. And then get basic metric data, we sell conference booking and analytics software. We help people optimize the way their people, places, and technology work together. So one of the key things that we need to know is how many licenses we're looking at, how many bookable spaces you have, whether, you know, you have desk hoteling where people can book out random desks within your office and you need to book those, how many conference rooms. So we get that data, we get decision-making criteria, and then also just a pulse check on their interest level.
Gotcha.
At which point we'll set the appointment, mark it as a sales qualified lead, and pass it over to the account executive. On the outbound side, we build our own leads. We do a big combination of, you know, tools that scrape the web. We buy leads. We also are huge believers in referrals, as you know, with my background working with Outro.
Yeah.
So we do all of that and have a very predictable revenue-esque sequence that, you know, we will email, call, social touches, and so forth.
Gotcha. And so at the top of the funnel, it's do you measure the number of net new contacts?
On the inbound or the outbound side?
On the outbound side.
On the outbound side, we don't worry too much about that. We know what we need to be at. Each of our SDRs goes after roughly 100 net new contacts a month.
Okay.
In terms of their compensation, it's based on how many qualified opportunities. So they know what they need to do, but I'm not breathing down their neck if I ask them to do 100 net new contacts and they do 95.
Yeah, fair enough. It's about we pay you for the results, not for the time that you're sitting in the chair.
Exactly. So, I mean, if the results aren't there and the activities that we've established aren't there, then we have a problem. If they can, if they can deliver results with a slightly lower amount of contacts, a slightly lower level of activity, we'll obviously work with them so that they can low quota out of the water as opposed to just barely hitting it. Mm-hmm. But they're not going to be in hot water with me as long as the results are still solid.
Cool. Do you mind if we walk quickly through your numbers? Like, so you expect 100 net new contacts that you're working every month. And then what is right. that? What
sorry, every week.
Every week. Cool. I misheard you there. So 100 net new contacts every week. And then what do you expect that to turn into?
We expect that to turn into 20 appointments.
Yeah.
Sorry, 20 appointments a month, not 20 per week. 20 appointments a month. So okay. 400 contacts a month. Turn into 20 appointments. And from those 20 appointments, we expect 16 of them to SAL or create a qualified opportunity. So we want an 80% appointment to opportunity rate.
Gotcha. And so do you comp on the SAL, the sales, SAL is sales accepted lead.
Correct.
Awesome.
Yeah. When I first came over here, it was a hot mess. I'm the first person to lead sales development at Teem. We had a handful of SDRs, but their process was essentially find 300 new people a day, send them a 3-email spam campaign that did not vary at all. Mm-hmm. And then in the words of Aaron and Jason in their new book, even a stop clock is right twice a day, right? So they would have some results, feel like they were doing good enough. But anybody that had a pulse that said, yeah, it's chat, they would mark that as a meeting.
Yeah.
And that's what they were comped off. So we flipped that around very, very quickly. So
before I'd love to hear what you guys are doing next, but is the sales accepted lead? Are your SDRs doing that first call?
They are hopping on the call, making the introduction to the account executive, but the account executive is the one that determines whether or not it is an SAL.
Gotcha.
So there likely will have been some discovery work done ahead of time. There needs to be on our team's side. Most of the time, that is the result of phone calls with the prospect.
Okay.
But my SDRs, they are not the ones that have the authority to SAL it.
Gotcha. But there is some like in between, you know, the 400 and the 16 SALs, they're definitely using the phone to jump on there.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Cool. So let's talk about that, because that's a really interesting point, going from the 300 spray and pray a day to, you know, let's focus on 400, but 400 a month. That's a huge shift. So how do you get the same results out of so few contacts?
Well, the week before I started here, we had 4 outbound SDRs who made a grand total of 18 phone calls the whole week.
Okay.
It's an average of less than one a day per person.
Yeah.
Right. And I feel like they read the first 2 or 3 chapters of Predictable Revenue and didn't finish it. Right. They have the belief that cold calling is dead, but had no idea what cold calling 2.0 is.
Yeah.
So we instituted a cold calling 2.0 mentality where, you know, we backed into our successes. We found the niche markets that have really performed well for us. So one of the great things about being part of this company is we have the who's who of SaaS companies as customers. Mm-hmm. Twitter, Uber, Airbnb, Snapchat, HubSpot, LinkedIn, they're all customers of ours. So we decided to take those niche markets that we've had success with and find similarities, right? Find other social networks like Snapchat, find other tech startups, and we have tech stars and 500 startups are customers of ours. So we did big outreach to other startup accelerators. We've got David Stern in the NBA, 4 or 5 different pro sports teams. Let's back into that and go after other pro sports teams and create very, very consistent data-driven outbound campaigns. And we're going to call on them, right? We're going to send them that first customized template. And then we're going to call on them. We're going to prioritize based on who's clicking and viewing our emails.
Yeah.
And then we're going to send them a second email. We're going to call them again. We're going to view their LinkedIn profile, chat with them on social, and really just have a consistent, steady cadence that we can measure and then A/B test off of. There was no A/B testing. It was literally the same exact 3 email sequence every time. They weren't improving on it. It was the same results.
Awesome. And like you said, it was sort of copy and paste. You're using templates and just sending templates and templates and templates. There was no personalization. Exactly. None of that.
None at all. None at all. We didn't know what our buyer personas were. I walked in and said, "Who's our customer?" And they said, "IT and facilities." I'm like, what do you mean? Like, IT and facilities? Yeah. Anybody that works in IT or facilities is our customer. That's not true. That's not true at all. I mean, coming from sales, I have a very real need for what our software does because I have a very long sales history and a lot of experiences getting kicked out of conference rooms mid-demo. Our software solves that. So let's look at that buyer persona. Let's look at HR helping improve the culture of the workplace. Let's look at what seniority level purchases from us. And we really started developing those buyer personas with our marketing team and then A/B tested like crazy. And we're still doing it.
Awesome. I love the sort of nail your niche buyer, like figuring out the buyer personas approach. We've seen that have a massive impact on tons of companies. And I think that's such a critical piece that so many people miss. And I'm super stoked to hear you sharing about this. What was your process there? Like, who was involved in coming up with your buyer personas and then creating these micro campaigns?
Yeah, so our marketing team, they already had some persona work done, but nobody was taking advantage of it. So I found what work they had done already. We're partners with HubSpot, and I just jumped into HubSpot and saw the personas that they had already created. And then we also just backed into the appointments that we have set, the deals that have closed, and started looking at the patterns. We found that IT directors, we found that facilities managers, executive assistants are definitely the three people that tend to purchase the most, but they're not the three people that tend to respond to our emails the most. So, I mean, we looked at the stats, right? We looked at who's viewing our emails, what's their role, and figured out exactly where our strong suits were, and we're just targeting those now.
Gotcha. So it's based on who's viewing, not necessarily responding, or?
All of it. View, respond, click, buy, everything.
Gotcha. And so for those, like, for the newer listeners that are maybe starting their first team, they're an SDR, maybe they're an SDR manager. Whose job is it to come up with this, with these personas or figure out these niches?
Well, I'm a firm believer that sales development is the bridge gap between sales and marketing. So sales development leaders should definitely be involved in that. Mm-hmm. Marketing should definitely be involved in that. Sales ops should be involved in it. I really think everybody should be. Ultimately, here our marketing team owns it. They're the stopgap, but we're very, very heavily involved in chatting with them and giving them feedback and making sure that we're very aligned.
Gotcha. So it's sort of a mix of all three teams working together. And then it sounds like it's you that's really taking these personas and turning them into these micro campaigns. Is that you, or are you passing that down to the sales development rep?
It's all of us. I've definitely spearheaded the effort, but I don't want to take too much credit. Our team's pretty smart. I've hired some smart people. There were some smart people here when I started. So we do in the field work. I mean, we're an inside sales team, so we're not literally in the field, but for an hour every week, I'm with each of our reps working on those things. We're looking at the data and using the tools that we have to replicate and then just slightly tweak based on different personas.
That's fantastic. We sort of hit our sort of target time here, but what would be a couple, maybe just one sort of key takeaway for those maybe newer SDR managers, and then one sort of ninja tactic or something special that that you sort of found as for our more advanced users?
Yeah. Okay. So maybe a key takeaway for newer people, as humans, we're all selective listeners. Like I mentioned, a lot of people I feel have read Predictable Revenue, just choose to ignore the latter half of the book. Traditional cold calling is dead, but that doesn't mean we're not supposed to pick up the phones. We're supposed to be reaching out to people with a data-driven approach that you can scale. That's the whole purpose of Predictable Revenue, is warming people up via email and then using data to tell your story and help you figure out exactly the right cadence, right? That's what I would say first. And then for, you know, for more experienced people that are familiar with account-based sales and marketing, I feel like a lot of people that claim to be, you know, disciples of account-based sales and marketing think that data doesn't matter anymore, that enterprise customers are way too mature to, you know, to respond to an email template. We shouldn't be doing campaigns to them. We're an account-based team. In reality, that's just an excuse for being a lazy outbounder, right? Account-based means you're doing research and customizing, but it does not mean that data shouldn't have a play in your organization. And it's definitely helped us really hone in on our target audience and deliver some pretty stellar results.
It sounds like just the extension of what you were talking about earlier. I mean, you talked about it was personalization and sort of customizing those first touches specific to the audience. It sounds like, if I understand you, the account-based approach, the way you see it, is just another way of personalizing the emails.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, you're focusing on the company, you're personalizing your campaigns based on the company, but you're not abandoning campaigns. You're not abandoning the tried and true sequences and touch points that have proven successful for you in the past.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Zach, I really want to thank you for joining and sharing some of your knowledge. This has been awesome.
You got it, man.
Awesome. Thanks, dude.